I'm one of the millers from us here, and I have the honor of introducing you very briefly. So she's a transdisciplinary field scientist, which whose work lies at the intersection of the social sciences. And I'm not going to say much about her because I think her work really speaks for herself. But for her PhD, she walked 3,000 kilometers with the wild bonobos in Congo. And she's currently a senior fellow at the Institute for Transdisciplinary Research on Institutions and Human Behavior. She's an associate professor at the Center of Complexity Research at the University del Desarrollo, Chile. She is a conservationist and works in applied complexity as a member of the Advisory Council member for long-term systematic strategies for science, technology, knowledge, and innovation for Chile's president. It's her first time at SFI. Quite a long time with her over the past few days, and I'm in awe of her energy, her curiosity, and her broad range of interests. So a scientist who loves the arts, literature, poetry, and culture, and what's not to love. So a very warm welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Andrea. That's the nicest introduction. And it's thanks to Andrea that I'm here. And as she said, it's my first time. I'm already delighted by all these wonderful colleagues and conversations that we've had in a few short days. So today I'm hoping to present an introduction and delving into different aspects of what has been my work in the past, mainly with the objective of catalyzing further conversations. So I really welcome all sorts of feedback and questions afterwards. I started as a biologist that transitioned into an anthropologist, and that has always been with a permanent interest in literature, philosophy, and the arts. So basically, I've been interested in the complexity and evolution from ancient life to current us. And my focus is, as I age, I think more into current us. But always keeping in mind the bigger picture. So having started as an evolutionary biologist, it was really nice to hear that Darwin had written, he who understands baboon would do more towards metaphysics than Locke, meaning that understanding of primate behavior actually would be very good to understand philosophy. That's very nice, but there's several problems with that. One that, of course, we cannot ask baboons how they feel, and that metaphysics has several problems. So my bias as a biologist was to start looking at the big picture of life, really trying to understand when did life begin, how does life create niches, and how does complexity of life evolve. So in that, I've spent quite some time looking at the major transitions of evolution that was written by John Maynard Smith and Sassmary about complexity increases in evolutionary time, which I'm sure here people would have very strong views and would love to hear them later. but basically, the transition that I focus on is a major transition to complexity that happened from primate societies and other animal societies to modern humans. So let's contextualize what I mean by modern humans. There's obviously human evolution, a context that let's think what's more or less happened the last 4 million years. So for the between the last 4 million years, you whatever kind of human relative you would see, you would identify as a relative belonging to the family of hominins, namely bipeds. So whether they are Australopithecines or Neanderthals. And of course, these are all our closest relatives, but the problem in terms of understanding their behavior is that they're dead, they're extinct. So in primatology and kind of the modern human sciences emerging synthesis, we try to look at an integration of paleoanthropology, what ancient DNA tells us, together with primate behavior. And so here you see the hominid family tree, namely extant family tree, i.e. the relatives that are alive. And the relatives that are alive are orangutans, gorillas, chimpanzees, and bonobos. And together with chimpanzees and bonobos, we share a last common ancestor, i.e. you do not descend from chimpanzees and bonobos, you are cousins. In the same way that we do not descend from our cousins, we share common ancestors, we share grandparents. Each species has followed their own evolutionary pathway, but we share a relatively recent common ancestor. So that's important to establish in order to discuss adaptive trade-offs that we will come later. And my focus wanted, I was wanting to understand between the comparison between social behavior of both species, but focusing on bonobos for two reasons. One is just curiosity. We know less about bonobos than we know about chimpanzees, so that gap in the map that drives us. And the second is that bonobos have very interesting features that are unusual in primates that help building a more complex feature, I mean, a more complex map of our evolutionary tree. So the first thing is like, okay, how do you study complexity in the wild? I wanted to study behavior and complexity in the field, and the field just go outside, and as you know, the field is messy in the complex. So there are all sorts of living things moving around, and they're difficult to quantify, and how do you operationalize principles? So I was recently listening to David Krakauer define complexity, and I really liked his emphasis on the balancing the power of on complexity science, trying to balance the power of prediction versus understanding, and trying to establish a balance between these two. So in doing that, bearing in mind the messiness of the field, I attempted to extremely oversimplify complexity to three overarching principles. The first one, connectivity, coordination, and networks, super broadly defined again. Let's go more into this later. Diversity or heterogeneity and energy. So connectivity or coordination is when previously independent units come together to form a higher level system. Whether cells, organizations, or animals, when two things that were not previously together come together. In the simplest of ways. Second, diversity or heterogeneity. These entities that come together, when they come together, they do so through division of labor, therefore giving rise to heterogeneity. So it's a heterogeneity that needs to be integrated. Third principle is energy. Energy expense measured in biological systems as metabolic energy in human systems, or for example, financial energy. Typically energy, so whether it's fruit in the forest or financial budgets in our organizations, complexity is expensive to maintain, but it seems to be the case that if you can afford that investment, then you can afford further increases in energy. For example, if you can afford to build a human brain, then having a human brain affords further increases in complexity. If you can afford to live in London and New York, it's expensive, but doing so, that allows for further increases in complexity. That's the simplification. And so modern humans today, we have, of course, several questions in relation to our complexity, but the most basic of them is that we evolved in small groups, and our minds evolved in small groups. Our cognition seems very adapted to small group living, such as evidenced in coalitionary psychology. Yet we are quite able to live in very large scales of social complexity and to coordinate in scales that have not even to do with person-to-person interaction, which is the context where primate coordination arises. So looking at this kind of natural history arc from animal societies to human societies, it's fairly obvious that when you're in the field, whether you observe large-scale human phenomena, such as public celebrations, festivals, football games, music, etc., we are able to coordinate and bond in group sizes that other primates really don't. So how do we do this? With this question in mind, I wanted to do ethology, old school 1970s style, going to the field with binocular, very low tech science. Spent 3 years south of the equator in the Democratic Republic of Congo collecting data on habituated group of wild bonobos. This is a site, this is the longest term study site for bonobos established by the Japanese in the mid 70s. By the way, the history of Japanese ethology is really interesting to note, that it's different from Western ethology, that they come more from sociology, looking at the origins of the human family, whereas, of course, our ethology comes more from Conrad Lorenz and biology. So anyway, that's a topic for conversation for drinks later. But you learn different ways of doing ethology. The field site, just for reference, is south of the River Congo, where the red dot is. Bonobos only live south of the River Congo, so if you wanted to study them in the wild, that's where you have to go. Previous to this, I compared bonobos and chimpanzees in captivity, which yields a lot of very interesting data. But I do think that however messy and however time expensive and difficult it is to get data in the wild, ecological field studies are still worthy and very important, because basically they allow you to situate species in their natural context. And therefore, the questions that we can ask later in experiments, in modeling studies, etc., I think will have ecological validity, and it will just be better questions if we still are somehow able to have field studies. Although, of course, the amount of data that you get is so small compared to non-field studies that it can often be painful. But there you go. Just so you know how it looks, this is like basically we follow a group of, again, wild habituated animals. Your aim is to be as boring as possible. You want to disappear. That's a good thing about long-term study sites, that basically you kind of are very boring to them because you don't want to interfere in their social behavior, especially if you're looking at sophisticated social interactions that are easily disrupted by stress or fear. Here you're also seeing a very basic type of problem in coordination, which is that of travel. So the group typically travels together, so you have adult males, adult females, infants, and juveniles. So the first question is like, how do animals coordinate travel, given there are different trade-offs in energy? So typically that is very evident in decision-making in travel, right? Like males typically want to go, females want to rest for longer, and I think there you can see there's one juvenile that as they travel, he's kind of spinning by himself, so he's playing solo play, which already begs the question, why is he doing that? This is an expensive behavior. Potentially, you know, he could like just whack himself against a tree. So appears to have a level of risk. So we'll go more into that later. But so comparing measures across different taxa and social complexity is hard. And I think here there will be several experts in that. Given obvious differences in group size, but not only in group size, but also phylogenetic distance. Because, for example, take this group of taxa. So this is the first quiz. What do they have in common? Some measure of social complexity and intelligence and longevity-ish. But what do they not have in common is also very interesting. What do they not have in common? Phylogenetic relatedness. You have mammals and you have birds in this select niche, I mean, in this select group of socially complex taxa. And the last common ancestor of mammals and birds lived 250, 300 million years ago. So you cannot possibly just explain the emergence of social complexity using a phylogenetic relatedness argument. However different they are in their origin, there seems to be a kind of niche that these animals are occupying that brings together complex sociality, complex cognition, and strong bonding mechanisms. These animals have relationships. The bond seems to be a coordinating mechanism in this social system. And more broadly, I think we can understand this as a social complexity niche that has to do with dealing with the complexity, not only of the environment, but with a specific complexity, which is that of managing social interactions. In 1976, Nicholas Humphrey wrote a paper called The Social Function of the Intellect in Growing Points Ethology, a volume that was edited by Patrick Bates and Robert Hind, and which really kind of launched this way of thinking, i.e. looking at social complexity and social cognition and complex social cognition together. He cites in the paper Alice in Wonderland saying, "You have no idea how confusing it is, all the things being alive," right? And there she is being thrown at all these cards, obviously pointing at the fact that however much variation, much or little variation you have in an environment, say you live in a temperate environment, so the variation will be from winter to summer, a lot of variation, but yet predictable. Or you live in the sea or in the tropics, that maybe less obvious variation, but very unpredictable. It's, living in social life brings its own niche of social, of unpredictability. So managing, having mechanisms to manage that, it will be very important adaptations for social animals. So let's look at bonobos. So bonobos, as you can immediately see, they're very similar to chimpanzees. They're difficult to differentiate unless you really know them. So a tip is a look at the hair in the middle. Bonobos have always black faces and hair that parts in the middle. So that's now you can identify a bonobo from a chimp. And they have unusual features. So they're female bonded, but unlike other matriarchies in nature, these females are not related. So females in both species, bonobos and chimps, disperse when they are adolescent. So that means that kin relationships have already a difference, i.e. in both species, males are more related than females are related. So that would, given kin selection, that predicts more cooperation in males than females, right, in both species. However, we find that in bonobos, females form strong coalitions and strong bonds, and not so much males, which is a very interesting question. They're also unusual in that they have sex for conflict reduction and forming bonds, and they're unusually cohesive and peaceful, bringing questions as to like the regulation of tension and conflict in social systems. So if you define bonding as a coordination mechanism, and then just look at which way do animals bond and which ways do animals behave. Do they always do the same thing, or do they have different ways of social interaction in the same way that we can have a conversation, we can make music, we can be on work mode, we can be on play mode, etc. So bonobos have, I think it's fair to say, they have social complexity at the very least defined in this way, different ways of behaving with different agents. I looked at the networks of four bonding behaviors, namely grooming, sex, proximity. This is social proximity. If you draw the social network, how often do you find that animals are within, say, two meters or less of each other? So these bonding mechanisms have different features, and they have different costs. Some of them are more expensive in energetic expenditure than others, and also some of them require more time investment than others. Let's have a look at some of them. So this is how grooming is. Rasanaru male, he's the dominant male of the group, and he's grooming an infant, a 1-year-old infant. The mother is behind, so she is at the time, she was 41 years old, and this was her fourth child. So that just puts into context that these animals are long-lived and slow reproducing. It also, this video features the fact that the high social tolerance of bonobos. So males, this male is not the father of this infant, and yet, of course, what you see, it's very tolerant. So that's another feature. We almost not see infanticide. Maybe there's a couple of cases, but there's a stark difference in the lethal aggression seen in both species. And it's been a long-standing question, what is the difference in these two social systems? How come they are so similar in so many ways? But yet, they think that the threshold of conflict, it's not that obviously bonobos don't have conflict, all biological systems have conflict, obviously, but they seem to manage conflict within a certain threshold that at least results in less lethal aggression. One of the mechanisms that we think that happens is through bonds of adult females. If you're an adult female, your reproductive output is obviously very expensive and very slow, so infanticide is a very bad thing for your investment. So anti-infanticide strategies are a good thing if you're a female mammal. And so in bonobos, because of resources in the forest, the first thing that allows a female to be in the same physical space required to form a bond is that they can and that there's enough resources. So bonobos have appeared to have managed to do that. This photo shows it, I think, quite obviously. This is a photo taken by the Japanese in the early 80s and that I took some 10 years ago. The point being that whenever you take data on a female, almost never you take a data point alone. The adult female is always next to another adult female. Therefore, they can build bonds, therefore, they can build coalitions. How do they build coalitions if they did not grow up together, if they're not related? Again, social proximity, food sharing, different behaviors, but also high emotional intensity behaviors such as play and sex play a role. Have a look at this. There's one female approaching another one. They're having sex. You can see the large vulva. You see that the infant is also very interested. Pointing, these are obviously highly sexual animals. This video is to keep you awake and thirsty. But also features a really interesting aspect, obviously, of social life in these animals, namely that, you know, until only relatively recently, we thought that non-reproductive sex was only a feature of human animals. Now we've seen it in cetaceans, in primates such as bonobos and others. But yes.
Is there an asymmetry in, like, this is a female behavior as opposed to, like, between male bonobos?
And I have the social network on sexual interactions. The most common pairwise interaction is adult female, adult female. The second one is adult female, adult male. The third one is adult female, juvenile. The fourth one is adult male, adult male. Mm-hmm. So in summary, all of them are bisexual, if you will, but there's a clear difference in the frequency. You see that, again, adult females are having most sex, particularly before feeding. So I think the function and bonding and conflict reduction.
Have you seen in person all possible combinations?
If I've seen all possible combinations?
Yeah. You've seen all of this happen?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. And I have the social network data if you want to see it. Yeah. There was another question? No. So one thing I wanted to keep in mind of the features of sex is that it takes little, the time budget is short and the energy budget relatively high, as well as the relatively risk of sex. And that is a very similar feature to the abstraction of play that we will come. So thinking on like how bonding works, So take immature and adult bones. Again, this is another unusual feature in bonobo societies, the lack of infanticide. So in bonobo societies, there's a lot of play. Play occurs, as usual, more widely in immatures. So babies and juveniles are, it's a biological universal that they're the ones that play more. We see that in vertebrate homeotherms, namely birds and mammals, the young, they play, right? But what's unusual is that typically play disappears when somatic maturation is achieved. So when animals grow up, they stop playing. So we have historically thought of play as a kind of biological scaffolding. You know, play is preparation for adulthood in the same way that the scaffolding of a building helps the building grow up, is developmental scaffolding. Once the building is complete, i.e. somatic maturation has achieved, scaffolding falls away, right? Play disappears. But yet, in this small set of species, play seems to continue. Of course, we play, we're curious, we make music, we explore, and other animals also play in adulthood. So retention of juvenile characteristics through evolution, it seems to be a feature that is concomitant with social complexity, I think, because of these features of play. So let's look at the social network of play. All of this is showing is play interactions between individuals, blue, very traditional males, in red, females. The lighter the color, the younger the individual. It's just showing you preferred play partners. And you can ignore idea, this individual here, she came in for only a couple of weeks, so that's why she's so external to the network. But what is that network showing you? The most basic thing is that play is pervasive and is a very connected network, and at the same time, they are clearly preferred play partners. So I got serious about studying the biology of fun, thinking that one of the main problems that evolution has for innovations, at least in social species, is that novelty is scary, and animals typically have novelty-avoiding mechanisms. So play as a kind of physiological technology that helps you go towards novel stimuli would obviously just at least increase the likelihood of animals wanting to interact with novel stimuli, as well as to create it. So I think in time, you see that play is expensive and is risky. When animals play, for example, they take more risks. They climb a tree, they're more likely to fall. Also, they're very locked in attention. Sometimes predation is higher when animals are playing. So, you know, you see two otters playing and they get predated by a raptor because they were so enthralled in play. Of course, and if you go visit the accidents and emergency unit and every Friday or Saturday night in the city, you see the injuries that are caused by play. And yet, play seems to persist. The basic idea here is that if you have a complex system being able to recombine elements and come up with novelty and basically face disruption is a good idea if you can afford it. So that's why I call the hypothesis the adaptive joker hypothesis, namely that the joker you cannot predict its exact value. The value is only determined by the current state of the players that are players and that are playing and the cards that you hold. So it's not like, you know, a number 3 or a 10 that you actually, it may work or may not. And it only works if you can afford it. So hence the cartoon, midway through the exam, Alan pulls out a bigger brain. Right. Let's look at some of the features of play and bonding. Plays, and usually in many ways, one of them is that it's underlined by dynamics of risk and trust, as well as entropy and social rules. So what these show is that you have an adult that is basically controlling the game. So you have a little guy that is being swinged, maybe 3-5 meters above the ground. So obviously they could let go. That's a risky thing. Why would animals take voluntary risk? There is no coercion here. Not only they take a risk, they exhibit positive emotion when doing so. They think it's fun. So this is rather strange. Let's look at it in a different way. There are other things that are risky. Here you have a male in the front with a female. They're playing kind of a ring of roses. You see that she's holding him? You see where? Yeah, thank you. It's a very vulnerable part of the male anatomy, and bonobos, because of they have sperm competition, as chimpanzees, they have very large testes, much larger than humans. So again, it's a funny video, but I think it poses a very serious question. Why would animals willingly take risks and seem to enjoy it? Other features of play are feedback loops. They're very sophisticated, fast feedback loops. Sometimes play has features of synchronicity, i.e. animals doing the same at the same time, like music and training in humans. Sometimes it has features of turn-taking and role-taking. So one animal chases, the other one escapes. They change roles in softer and harder play. Of course, we engage in role-taking in theater, but also in conversation, in dance, and in music making. These feedback loops entail you have to watch them like in slow motion when you watch play to really understand what's going on in the terms of like the social signals. I'll just show you a video that I think is very easy to observe in any park. That's why I'm showing you this, is between the size difference, therefore the risk difference between a large animal and a small animal, that yet they agree to play. In this case, it's a wolf dog and a chihuahua, and they're playing. The basic question here is that it's dangerous. So why would, again, a chihuahua want to engage in this dangerous behavior? And just try to look at like the feedback loops between them. Approach, bite. These are elements from aggression that are regulated, so play has rules. Push that to boundaries, mistake, I'm sorry, okay. And go again, and the loop starts. Sometimes to greater intensity, sometimes to decreasing intensity. Play is expensive, it requires time, but it's just at the most basic level energetically expensive. To dance and to hike is more energetically expensive than to sit or to walk slowly. And that is true for us and is true for other animals. So again, if you are an animal in the wild facing the same problems that animals face, namely you have to travel, maintenance, energy, why would you spend energy in this behavior? To have an idea, let's look at some trade-offs. So you have two different bonding behaviors, as I mentioned, play and grooming. This photo shows, so grooming, it's more expensive in time, but cheaper in energy. It's slower. A grooming session might take, of your time budget, if you're a bonobo, between 30 minutes to 1.5 hours. Play sessions are shorter, but are more energetically expensive. So what happens when environment changes, times of plenty with times of scarcity? The first thing is like times of scarcity are relative in bonobos. Bonobos live in forests that they're still relatively wealthy, so to say. But what changes is fruit availability. And of course, fruit availability is like a lot of energy that can be consumed like meat in a very short time. So when there's low energy, low fruit availability versus high energy, high fruit availability, you see how the social system shifts from one bonding mechanism to another. And so we would have thought that grooming being so foundational and so important for primates that everything would increase. But actually, grooming does not increase. Play goes through the roof.
Yes. Energy times the time is something called the action in physics.
Uh-huh.
So this is like the action is conserved, or is there a minimization principle here? Principle of least action? You know, it's a well-established principle in physics. Mm. It's an action principle. And systems try to minimize action. Here, they're trying to preserve the action.
Right. So that's why I think it's interesting. You would assume that the system is trying to minimize the action, therefore at times of extra energy, they should just be resting more. But instead, they seem to be investing in this high energy cost behavior. I don't know why. I mean, we have guesses, but they're definitely investing, they're definitely expending more energy. I don't know if that answers your question at all.
You can write down the action principle.
Yes, I would love to. Okay. Yeah, I need to learn so many things. So let me see. First of all, how long should it be? Do we keep like 10 minutes for questions, 15 minutes for questions?
The seminar in total is an hour.
Yeah.
Whatever you.
Okay. So maybe let me go quickly here because I think questions will be most interesting. So just wanted to show you that basic finding of that play rates increase where resources are higher. And this is true for adults, it's true for infants, it's true also for measures of motor intensity, for group size. Animals play in more like larger groups, they play louder, they laugh more, polyadic play happens. So kind of, if you want to make a comparison, it's kind of like times of summer festival type thing. When social groups will go and incur in costs to meet others and involve in exchanges. This does not happen in sex and does not happen in grooming and does not also happen for social proximity. And different measures of diversity in play are also concomitant with energy increases. Again, I mentioned it. Not also the rates by the diversity of partners and also the ways that animals play. There's low and high fruit season for adults. So the change in different age classes is also important to look because although all animals obviously transition to this different environmental state of higher fruit, actually there's a difference. If you're an immature, immatures are buffered. So their shift is not as profound as those of adults. Namely, immatures are buffered by lactation. So as expected, also their play behavior does not change that much as the one of the adults, who are the ones that suffer the bigger shift. Not only play, I was telling you, increases within the community, but also we have this extremely unusual feature of like intergroup encounters. During times of plenty, the bonobo group will go outside of the territory, meaning they cross a river that typically is a very consistent boundary with what it looks as if to meet other groups. This is a dangerous thing to do, and again, the issue of risk, because typically there's aggression between different primate communities. Bonobos, of course, as I was telling you, is a safe social environment. Again, the question of how do you regulate conflict in systems, which contrasts quite starkly with the adaptive strategies of chimpanzees that have been shown consistently to have as part of their behavioral repertoire lethal aggression, namely male chimps coordinate and patrol the borders of the territory. They seem to be very good at judging differences in group size. So say, for example, you have five chimps that are patrolling the border and they find one chimp, like they will attack and kill, like in this photo. This is the work by Richard Rangham and colleagues. This does not happen if, say, you're 5 versus 3, again, pointing at the obvious fact that it is a dangerous thing to do. But it's a strategy that exists in one social system and not in the other. Obviously, there's been a lot of speculation in the sense of what does this tell us for human conflict in the context of human evolution. Again, I point out to Richard Rangham's work on this. So bonobo groups venture out of the territory to meet others, and they have this interactions with other communities. Our assumption was that there was no interaction between groups, but in nature, interaction happens. And what kind of interaction? All sorts of interaction. So there's conflict, there are fights, but there's also sex, grooming, and play. And so there are, again, risk trade-offs. For example, this footage, I hope it exemplifies it. These are two males from different communities that they're playing. It seems like quite a peaceful interaction, but again, in the same context, two different males in different communities in chimpanzees, you get a very different result. I'm going to start to wrap, but just thinking about these features of play and of different types of bonding in primates, obviously we go back to the early question of scale. So the most basic observation being that modern humans bond in larger group sizes and how. Play group sizes large are up to, say, 7 individuals maximum. Grooming often happens between 2, say 3, and typically you have dyadic and triadic interactions, sex the same, but it's very rare to see kind of a group size larger than 6 or 7. Obviously very different than what we find in humans. This is the painting by Brugel the Elder in the mid-1500s, children's game, so, you know, showing dyadic and triadic play in humans, but also showing another obvious feature of human behavior that we aggregate in large public spaces and engage in this very large coordinating phenomena that, as evidenced in, again, festivals and soccer, football, and other types of ritual. So, coming from the work of the work that I did with in the lab of Robin Dunbar, basically we're trying to put together the natural history of this kind of foundational bonding mechanisms to bonding mechanisms in humans that many of them seem to be underpinned by the same biological scaffolding that you can call them coordination technologies, namely laughter, music, dance, feast, and celebrations. What they have in common is the physiological substrate of play, the motivational rewards of play, the bonding results of play, but of course not the large group size bonding than play. So again, we see this evidence in all forms of like modern behavior, whether it's bonding, but also risk-taking in humans, whether it's this kind of like, oh, it's fun, let's climb a moving structure, or let's climb a mountain. These things are dangerous, yet we explore and we do them. And I think with this, I'm going to close. We could go to ancient evidence on ancient feasts and festivals, but I think we'll leave that to a different time, because I would really love to hear questions and feedback. So, yes, I wanted to ask, I think, to put the question to you guys that I encountered this paper that was published a long time ago on how does actually SFI do it in order to be so good at interdisciplinary research, which begged to me the question of this thing of like integrating diversity and the cost of coordination. One thing is to bring scholars from different spaces. Another thing is to have them actually collaborate in something that is integrated. So I thought of that in the context of this kind of bonding behaviors and wondered why SFI was so good at it. And now I feel very grateful to be here and see it in person. So with that, thank you. Yes.
I'd love to hear more about, through your work, how you've seen the ethological perspective and the complexity perspective interact, like point complement and conflict. Because I got the idea through your talk that this common ethological or characteristic ethological idea that you go in the field to get like high quality, more complex data, or data that allows you access to the more sort of complex dimensions of behavior.
Yeah.
I can see that working. Is that right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, and I hope that I was able to make clear that obviously from an ethological perspective, you realize that it's very difficult to operationalize and to measure simple overarching principles of complexity, especially in a way that they produce data that then could be hopefully integrated into kind of wider range complexity analysis. Now, there's so much there. And the other obvious point is that, say, if you want to abstract it, the bias from ethology is the bias, let's say the emphasis of ethology is the emphasis of evolutionary biology, which is reproductive output. So you're looking at time, and you're looking at history, and you're looking at reproductive output. But not always that converses with structure and emergent phenomena, which is obviously what complexity is looking at. And obviously, I would say that, you know, complexity would benefit from not only just looking at agents that as interaction between agents, but also are put into this more complexifying phenomena, such as the difference in age and sex reproductive strategies, because especially when you look at energy budget and then time budget, and you look at the trade-offs between them, I think that is a powerful tool to illuminate this kind of overlap or interaction between complexity and ethology, if that makes sense. Because the most basic point is that an energy budget can go, at least theoretically, infinitely, right? Humans can win the lottery, animals can find more food, there can be innovations that are better, are yielding solar power, right? So your energy budget can go up, whereas time budgets are fixed. All organisms have 24 hours in a day. Of course, some organisms live more than others. But once you recognize that and you see how the trade-offs shift according to environmental context, I think that's an analytic tool that is very helpful in this overlap between ethology and complexity. I don't know. Okay. Yes, you and then you. Yes.
So you mentioned many times music.
Yes.
But I'm wondering here, from a musicological point of view, there is this kind of assumptions that all human society have music, but animal society is kind of a question mark. And you mentioned something like synchronization at play. So do you have other evidences that can point to some kind of origin of music in a way abstracted from what we consider music, because we are completely biased by, you know, our experiences.
Yeah.
Music can be many different things.
Yeah, so as I speak, I'm gonna try to show you a video that shows that. But from the point of view of the most basic building block, that is entrainment.
Mm-hmm.
The ability of one animal to do the same at the same time. So, of course, you know, the building block, you would say, you can see in flocking of birds, in the shoaling behavior of fish. But later, in terms of entrainment, I don't think primates have it. I think parrots have it. That's not surprising. Parrots are vocal animals that have language as part of their adaptive repertoire. So, but let me see if I find it, because it's actually quite. So anyway, entrainment. I need to show it to you later.
Yeah.
But I think my answer would be, where do you look at in the phylogenetic tree, if that's what you're asking? Is like to look at the emergence of entrainment. So for instance, bonobos have percussion, but I don't think they have contagion of percussion. They don't have entrainment of percussion, which is a subtle but important distinction.
Thanks for a wonderful talk.
Well, thank you.
There are a bunch of models about the evolution of what I would call institutions, probably also you, that is rules of the game, how people or animals interact. But
but in this case humans, in which because of the conventional nature of institutions, meaning their mutual best responses, they tend to be inertial because...
They tend to be inertial?
Inertial.
Inertial, okay.
Because obviously, if you're in a situation which everyone's driving on the right, it's very hard to shift over to driving on the left because everyone has to do it at the same time, like Sweden did. But that's true for all kinds of rules of the game.
Yeah.
So there's this natural conservatism of things which are societally, at a societal level, take the form of what's called in game theory a convention.
Yeah.
So if you get stuck in one of these conventions that isn't really very good, then in most of these models, there are two processes which are used mathematically to generate shifts to a possibly higher level. One is, ever since Sewell Wright and the 30s, obviously mutation. But in humans, we have, in many of the models, we just have mistakes. So we're all operating in some way, but then, you know, as long as there's a probability that you can change from driving on the right to driving on the left, it's certain that eventually everyone one day is going to wake up and drive on the other side. It'll hardly ever happen, right? But so it's mistakes. You hit the wrong button. And now that is a really impoverished way of studying how you shift from one place to the other. It's not, you know, when Rosa Parks refused to go up her seat on the bus, she didn't make a mistake. She was coordinating with others. Now, what I've learned from what you're saying here is that play has a similar role. It's an exploratory role for things that, which, I mean, if you didn't play, you'd always be doing the thing which is reinforcing the status quo. So I think play is, I mean, it's a, you know, play could be very fruitfully introduced in some of these models in the place of noise. Because basically it's noise generating the transitions from one basin of attraction to the other. And for in human society, we should really try to figure out what the noise is. And probably one of the things that's the noise is play.
Thank you. I completely agree. And I think there's a way of quantifying, you know, the directions of that noise in the sense that play has like a recombined. It's similar to the evolution of sex in the history of life, in that it has a kind of recombinatory function.
But actually, following up on this point, you state that play is, on the one hand, allows for social complexity, and that social complexity allows for dealing with novel situations.
I think play is a behavior that generates complexity, that rewards complexity, and that builds the cognitive and social flexibility that in turn helps social animals to deal with that complexity. So the feedback loop goes both ways. If that makes sense.
But if you want to sustain that system, you somehow have to encounter during the lifetime of individuals situations where that social complexity plays a crucial role.
Yes.
Otherwise, over evolutionary time, we actually would. Disappear.
Absolutely.
Do you have any indication where this actually happens?
Yes, I think literature, fiction, and theory of mind are good examples, because these are modern human examples of how we use play. And you could argue that actually this is how we develop further understanding of further social worlds. So how is it that you travel in Russia? How is it that you can understand the life of a 15-year-old 500 years ago through fiction, and you know, presumably being able to navigate better complex social worlds by having more of these tools is actually a very good thing for a complex social animal like us. However, you need to be able to afford it, whether it's time to read or the social structure that allows for people to generate this kind of art.
Yeah, thank you. Really, really interesting talk. So, one of the things I'm seeing from across the phylogenetic tree, right, you have different levels and types of play. And Homo sapiens.
Yeah.
Taking it to within the species.
Yeah.
Well, the place we have the best data for that, of course, is Homo sapiens. I want to hear your take on a couple of ideas that I've heard, right, on kind of on play. And one was introduced in this book, the
Brian Hare.
Yeah. So this notion that that tracks that facilitate play and cohesiveness run the rapid selection.
Yeah.
Fairly recently in our associated. So there's
Brian Hare was working with dogs and bonobos. So like how self-domestication makes animals friendlier.
I'm curious, would you take us on that? And then somewhat relatedly, kind of the more modern take that as social group size has increased in Homo sapiens, the quality of bonds has decreased. Okay, right?
Yeah.
And by extension, perhaps the quality of play and the benefits of play. Yeah. So this is another kind of set of ideas.
Yeah. I don't think the quality of bonds has increased. Actually, I should have mentioned that. Thank you. Because the answer to that apparent conundrum is in fission fusion. Fission fusion is a very important aspect of social complexity. Namely, in chimpanzees, bonobos, cetaceans, elephants, humans, we are not always with our whole social group all the time. We fission and we fusion, right? In smaller subgroups, the mourning family, your colleagues, your extended family, your imaginary friends for that matter. Bonobos do the same, chimps do the same. The point is that you have very intense bonds within smaller groups, but also you have weak bonds. So the different types and the subgrouping of fission fusion in the different social animals, I think, are a way for examining social complexity at large, but also solving that problem of strong bonds and weak bonds at the same time, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Thank you.
There's
a question.
Andy should have a question.
Oh, Andy Dobson. Oh my God.
Yeah. Hi. That was a super interesting talk. I have like 50 questions, but I remember talking to Alison Jolly about 20 years ago when she first went to see bonobos, and she noticed that there were gestures that bonobos made that chimps, the other chimps don't make, but were very similar to things that small children make. Do you ever see gestures such as that?
Yes.
Things like the sort of moving your hand, so it's doing like this,
that
bonobos make, but chimps don't.
I think chimps have a very complex set of gestures. So you want to read chimpanzee cultures in, I'm sorry, I'm just blanking his name now. I will send you the book. Who has done comparative research in gestures, both in mostly in chimpanzees, but some in bonobos, looking at kind of cultural variation in gestures. But both species have it. And for sure, you see gestures in infants that are similar to humans, I think. Whether they complexify different in both species, I wouldn't be able to answer that. But for sure, they're present in both species.
Just to sort of follow up to that, when you look at forest elephants and compare forest elephants to the savannah elephants, the savannah elephants have much more complex vocalizations, much more complex social organization than the savannah elephants have much more complicated social organization than the forest elephants. But that must be relatively recently derived, because they only had savannas to move out into over the last 3 million years or so.
Right.
But do you know if they see similar things with the few studies of savannah chimps? And why did the bonobos not go out into the savannah, or did they? And did they become us?
Yeah, I don't know enough about elephants to answer that question. My only guess is that even though 3 million years is a relatively small amount of time, actually, for large, very plastic animals, it's actually a long amount of time to modify social behavior given differences in territory and resource availability. And I think especially if you're a large animal, you have constraints, you have energetic constraints. Being a large animal in the jungle is very difficult. First, because there isn't much food, relatively speaking, I think for elephants, but also because visual communication is very difficult. So social strategies might be curtailed. But my guess would be that in elephants, the explanation is resource availability in savannah, coupled with just the visual communication, like being able to establish these like large coalitions that you see when elephants travel, I don't know, 20, 30, sometimes 40. And we know this because of Phyllis Lee research, of course.
Fantastic talk. Great to see you.
Thank you, Andy. It's nice to see you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that it's Monday and everybody came. And I'm obviously not a physicist, and I'm willing to learn and have a conversation with anyone that's interested. And I have a lot of data to play with if you want to test any of these ideas. And I would love to
quantify the energy time.
Yeah, I would love to do that.